Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this Sabbath day. Thank you for this worship experience here today. Our hearts have already been blessed. And we know that you will take us even to a higher place as we continue to worship you here today. Bless your word in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Word came to Jesus. The one you love is sick. Jesus said that the sickness is not unto death. You see, the truth of the matter is Lazarus had already died when Jesus said these words, but he knew, Jesus knew, that the end result would bring honor and glory unto God. God would not allow death to have the victory this day. Amen. But it's interesting that when he received the word about his friend, and this was his dear friend, he spent perhaps more time with this family than any other family while he ministered on earth. Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And when he heard that his dear friend was sick, the Bible says that he stayed where he was as if he didn't care. In John's gospel, there are three times when someone near and dear to Jesus makes an indirect request. Notice that they simply said, the one you love is sick. There was no real request, but in actuality, there was a request. In John's gospel, three times this happens. The other two times are when his mother at the wedding of Cana said to him, we have no more wine. Remember that? She never asked him for anything. She just said to her son, we have no wine. And then she said to the servants around him, do whatever he tells you to do. Another time, his brothers were on the way to Jerusalem, and they also had an indirect request, and he responded the same way. It appears at first as though he actually refuses their indirect request. But then he fulfills it after asserting that to these individuals that, listen, my time is not your time. I operate on my own time. Through his actions, Jesus demonstrated to us then and now that his delays, get this, his delays are not necessarily denials. For they will bring greater glory to God. Amen.
Amen.
After explaining a few things to his disciples, for when you go to John's gospel, he hears that Lazarus is sick, John chapter 11. He stays, the Bible says in verse 6, where he was for two more days. Then he says to his disciples, let us go to Judea again. His disciples saying to him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and you are going there again? Remember what happened the last time we were there? They didn't like your message then, and they certainly will not like it now. Jesus says to them, listen, are there not 12 hours in a day? And then he goes on and he says, well, if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth because there is no light in him. If a man walketh in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of the world. What Jesus was really saying, I'm not worried about these guys who are trying to stone me or who may try to stone me, because as long as we operate in the daylight, amen, I can see what's coming. Somebody say amen. I can get out of the way. I'm not going to stumble in the light, but you don't understand. Things can happen to you at nighttime. Oh, yeah. Jesus was trying to explain a few things to him, and they even questioned the fact, is he sleeping? He's sleeping, right, Lord? And then Jesus just had to say, listen, Lazarus is dead. He's dead. He's gone. But he said something else. He said later on, I go and I'm going to wake him up. Somebody say amen. Amen. He's not going to be dead long. He's not going to be sleeping long. I go and wake him up. Amen. Jesus did not say, you'll find it there twice there in that passage of scripture. One time he says, let us go. Another time he says, I go. When he said, let us go, he's saying something to us today that's very important. Jesus never brings his people into any type of peril where he does not accompany them. Somebody say amen. He goes with us even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. He is there. That's why we can fear no evil. He's with us. I go. Let us go. I have a job to do. I'm going to wake him up. Martha apparently was a little bolder than Mary. Jesus arrives in Bethany, not far from Jerusalem where he was, maybe a couple of miles away, which also begs the question, well, what took you so long? You were just a stone's throw away. Martha, being the bolder of the two sisters, goes out to meet Jesus. And they have a moment together where they are conversing with one another. And then she gets into saying to Jesus Christ, she's doing two things. She's affirming her faith in Jesus Christ. And at the same time, in her own way, she's chastising Jesus Christ. Imagine that. The nerve of anybody to chastise Jesus Christ. To question him and to debate with Jesus Christ. He is Lord of Lords, King of Kings. But Martha, she says, Jesus, if you had been here, if you had been here, my brother Lazarus would have been saved. He would have never, ever died. She was saying, Lord, we trust you so much. We know your power and we believe in you. We have faith in you, but you should have been here. Jesus didn't worry about that. And that's how sometimes we have to be with one another. Amen? We can't be so quick to retaliate against what somebody says to us sometimes, because sometimes they are going through something. Martha was going through something. She had just lost her brother. She didn't know what Jesus was going to do, even though Jesus had it all worked out. Somebody say amen. Jesus said to her, Martha, let me just help you out a little bit. Don't worry about anything. Your brother will rise again. Amen. She's not understanding that. So she says, wait a minute. I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. But Jesus had to help her out as he had to help out the disciples earlier. And he says these infamous words. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection. Martha, you don't understand some things. Your brother will rise again, because I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, they will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me, everyone, they will never, ever die. That's a promise.
Amen.
Every everyone who believes in me, who lives and believes in me, they will never die. That's the eternal death.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus proclaims, I am the resurrection and the life. What was he really saying? What did these words mean? Are they the same thing or are they different? When Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life, he was proclaiming that he was both the source of the resurrection and he was the life of the resurrection. He is the resurrection, which means that those who believe in him, they will live even if they die. Think about that.
Amen.
You can die. You can die. But you can live forever. You can die. But you will not really die because you may die the physical death, but God will raise you up in the spiritual life and you will live forever and ever and ever. That's why when our loved ones die, Brother Sister Richardson, we don't worry about things. You know why? Because if they die in Christ, we have hope that they will live again. What we need to do is make sure that we are living in Christ right now so that when we die, it will not be an eternal death. It will just be a death unto the glory of God, because remember, he is the resurrection and the life. Jesus does more than give life. Jesus is life. And therefore, death has no ultimate power over Jesus, because death cannot coexist with life, as light cannot coexist with darkness. Jesus confers this spiritual life on those who believe him so that they too will share in his triumphancy over death itself. He offers us eternal life to everyone that believes in him. You see, there is no resurrection apart from Jesus Christ. And if there is no resurrection apart from Jesus Christ, it stands to reason that there is no eternal life apart from Jesus Christ. So you and I would do well to act on the commands of God today. Her response was, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world. I believe. You see, at some point, it's all about our believing. Do we really believe? Do we really believe in Jesus Christ? Do we believe enough to offer ourselves and to give ourselves to God, even if it means giving up certain things? Do we believe? Not long after this conversation Jesus had with Martha, and his disciples are all around him. They have traveled with him. Jesus offers some commands. In verse 38, in verse 39 of John chapter 11, it's right there. Take a look at it. Jesus says, Jesus therefore groaned again in himself, the Bible says, cometh to the grave. It was a cave and a stone laid upon it. Jesus said, take away what? Take away the stone. Command number one. Take away the stone. In other words, remove this thing that is in the way. It's blocking me. I can't get to Lazarus. He can't get to me. Jesus shows once more how he is moved, if you will, by human affliction. comes to the stone, the cave, as it were. And he says, just take away the stone. Now, you got to understand something. We're not talking about a little rock here. Huh? This thing has been sealed. It's been sealed. I got a few stones in my yard. Amen. And I'm about to get rid of some of them. Oh, yeah. But in order for me to get rid of the stones that I have in my yard, I got to go out and either rent some type of machinery, some tractor with a backhoe or a front load. I got to get something. Because the truth of the matter is, I can't lift those stones. Some of those stones are just too heavy for me. I have a couple little rocks I can move around. But the stones, they're huge stones that are just sitting there embedded in the ground. I can't get to them. I need some help. And even if some of you brothers were to come out and help me, we would have a hard time getting those stones out because of their size. And the fact that they've been embedded in this ground for many, many years. But here's a stone that's in front of a tomb, in front of the grave, and it's a large stone. And Jesus says, take away the stone. I could imagine if we were there, we'd all be looking at us like, who, me? You talking to me? You think I can move that stone by myself? I'm not me. Then we're going to look. Every deacon is going to look at the next deacon. Then we're going to start trying to figure out how we're going to do this thing. Do we push all in the same direction? Do we rock it? Do we pry it loose? How do we do it? Jesus didn't care about any of that stuff. All he said was take away the stone. And he didn't even say who to take it away. Whoever was there and heard it, they ought to have listened and obeyed the command and removed the stone. Yeah. The stone represented the one thing that stood between Jesus and Lazarus and Jesus, and the Lord wanted it removed.
Amen.
Notice, Jesus doesn't say destroy it. He didn't say destroy the stone. He didn't say break it up. Maybe we would have got out there with a sledgehammer and tried to break it into little pieces and move each piece. But God doesn't say that. He doesn't say destroy it. He says move it, remove it. See, the truth of the matter is there are some stones in your life and mine that need to be moved from where they are right now to a place which will cause Jesus Christ to get closer to you. Are you listening to me today? There are some stones that are in the way of you and your God. Your relationship with somebody might be a stone. Your job might be a stone. Money might be a stone. Your clothes even might be a stone. Your busy schedule might be a stone. Social media! Snapchat might be a stone. You see, they, young people don't use Facebook that much anymore. They do Snapchat because, their parents can't get into that so fast. Amen. Before the parents figure out what's going on, it's already been removed. That's how that thing works. Oh, yeah. Figure it out, parents. But these things might be stones. Let me caution you about something else. There might be some individuals who are close to you or who want to get close to you. They might be stones in your life. And you got to remove these stones because these stones are interfering with your relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me move on. I challenge you this morning to remove the stones that may be standing in the way of your relationship and allow God to get as close to you as close can be. When Jesus said this, the Bible says he didn't whisper. That's why I don't believe in whispering in church. Amen. The Bible says that with a loud voice, he said, Lazarus, come forth, Lazarus, come forth. And the Bible says that something started stirring in the tomb, and before you know it, there was Lazarus. It wasn't enough to hear the voice of God. Obedience needed to take place, but a response was required. Oftentimes we hear the voice of God, but do we respond to the voice of God? When Jesus calls, you and I must respond. Some theologians believe that if Jesus had not been specific and identified Lazarus, that when he cried out, come forth, every grave would have opened up. So we have to call Lazarus by name. All the tombs would have been empty that day. Imagine that. Talk about dead men walking, huh? Oh, yeah. Look closely at the verse. Lazarus was commanded to do something that no one had ever been asked to do. Lazarus was commanded by the Lord to do something that really didn't make any sense. And do you find yourself sometimes being commanded to do something that really doesn't make sense? It doesn't make sense to you. It doesn't make sense to those that are around you. But you do it because it's a command of God. It didn't make sense for a dead man to come out of a tomb. That did not make sense. But what was happening was, you see, when you respond to God, you go in a new direction, amen. When you respond to God, you do a new thing, a new ministry. Your personal life changes. Your witnessing changes. You might even get baptized. Somebody can say amen. When you respond to God, you start keeping the seventh day the right way. Amen. Keep the Sabbath holy. When you respond to God, you become a spiritual disciple of God. When you respond to God, church is not an option. It's something that you do because you know it's what God wants you to do. So you can't pick and choose when you go to church. That's what we do. Well, the sun is shining today. I'll go. Well, we got a guest preacher today. I'll go. Well, so-and-so is singing today. I'll go. Well, so-and-so is not going to be there today. I'll go. Church should not be an option based on what you think is happening or not happening. If the one thing is happening, that is God. The presence of God is in church all the time because his angels are with us. Even when we're not around, there he is. When you respond to God, your giving is different, huh? The church won't have to worry about any money to take care of the ministry when you respond to God. It's one thing to remove the stones. It's another thing to respond to the voice of God. Lazarus came out. Lazarus came out. You know the story. Think about it. Jewish tradition lets us know that his feet were wrapped with strips of linen, a cloth around his face. The sheet was twice the length of his body. Half of the sheet was underneath and the other half on top. He's wrapped in this thing, and try to come out of something. Try to get out of your bed in the morning all wrapped up in your blanket and try to walk around your house. You'll be doing a hopping thing. Yeah. Maybe that's what happened. I don't know. I wasn't there. You weren't there. I don't know how Lazarus, did he float out? Did he hop out? Did he jump out? I don't know how he came out. All I know is when Jesus called him, he came out. He came out. Jesus commanded them the next command, take off the grave clothes, loose him, and let him go. A command of release. Yeah. Yeah. You see, See, a miracle took place, but Lazarus was still quite limited. Many of us have had great experiences with God, but we are still limited by things that have us all wrapped up. Lazarus was wrapped in his hands, his feet, his face, his mouth. What are you wrapped up with? How are you wrapped up? Are you wrapped up with worldly pleasures? Are you wrapped up with bad relationships? Are you wrapped up in intimidation? Are you wrapped up with your employment to the point you can't wake up on Sabbath morning because you had worked the third shift? I skipped the second one. Went right to the third one. We all wrapped up. Let me tell you something. I understand how money is important. I understand we've got to sustain ourselves. We got to eat. We got bills to pay. But let me tell you something. I'd rather have Jesus, somebody else said, huh? I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have Jesus than have riches untold. Somebody ought to say amen today, because I don't care what you might have, if you're not wrapped up in Jesus, if you're not wrapped up at all. Allow the Lord to release you today from anything that has you wrapped up. And when God releases you, something else happens. He restores you, amen. Lazarus needed restoration. How many of us need restoration today? I need restoration. You need restoration. We all need restoration. I'm here to tell you today, let not your heart be troubled, amen. Why? Because God says, I will release you, amen. I will restore you, amen. Why? Because I am the resurrection and the life, amen. My peace I leave with you. I will never leave or forsake you, because I am the resurrection and the life. When we leave this side of eternity, when we leave this side of earth, when we leave this island called the universe, then we will reach home, and our name is written over there. Our citizenship is over there. Our Savior is over there. Our inheritance is over there. Why? Because Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. I will restore you. Nobody else can restore you. Our Lord is clear on how we are restored and how we obtain eternal life, where he says, I am the resurrection. Those of you who believe in me, though you may die, you will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me, God says, will never ever die. I like that, because even though death looms around me, I don't have to worry about death, because if I die in Christ, I'll live with Christ forever and ever and ever. Let me bring this to a close. Do you believe? Do you believe that he is the resurrection and the life? If anyone believes, they'll live. Therefore, many of the Jews who have come to visit Mary had seen what Jesus did. And guess what? The Bible says they put their faith in Jesus Christ. Verse 45. Others saw what Jesus did in Lazarus' life, and they put their faith in God. What does all of this say to us today? It says to us, the last command is that we must reveal to others what God has done for us. Reveal to others what God has done for you. St. Francis of Assisi said, at all times preach the gospel, and when necessary, use words. Amen. In other words, what he was saying was, reveal Jesus Christ to others by your living, by how you live your life. If that doesn't work, then you got to use some words, but you should never have to use words if you're living right. If you desire this fullness, remove the stones that lie in front of your tomb, amen. Those things that are quenching your spirit, those things that are keeping you from a full life in Jesus Christ. In our story today, the people obeyed Jesus. They removed the stones from the tomb of death. And that is what faith will do for you. When you have the right kind of faith, you will remove whatever is in the way of you and God. Yielding every aspect of your life and allowing God to be God, God to be Lord, God to be the King of your life. We ought to sing that song every now and then. Lord of my life, I crown thee, O Lord. I crown thee King of my life. We're in the midst of our tears, in the midst of our weeping with faith, a disciple of Jesus still can trust God and still can follow God. Faith does not mean that you and I will not feel some pain sometimes. That's not what faith means. Faith doesn't mean that you won't have a moment of weakness sometimes. That's not what it means. Faith does not mean that we will never feel a sense of brokenness sometimes, because sometimes you will feel broken. Faith doesn't mean these things. Faith doesn't even mean that you've got to understand everything. Because the truth of the matter is, you can't know everything. We are still working towards perfection. We are still working towards the kingdom of God. We will not understand everything. But faith does mean this. It means that in spite of death, in spite of adversity, in spite of the fears that I have, in spite of the tears that I cry, it means that our trust remains constant in Jesus Christ, no matter what's going on around me in my life. So if my loved one dies, I still have faith. If I lose everything that I have had in life, I still should have some faith. If I don't know where I'm going to sleep tomorrow, I should have enough faith to know that Jesus Christ will find a place for me. Foxes have holes, birds have nests, the Son of Man had nowhere, but guess what? The sparrows don't even worry about where they're going to eat tonight and where they're going to sleep tonight. Jesus never worried about anything. He simply says to us, follow me. Have faith in me. Believe in me. Trust in me. Remember, I am the resurrection and the life. God wants to release us today from all bondage. Why? He is the resurrection and the life. He came to set you free. Why did he come to set you free? Because he is the resurrection and the life. He has the power over sin, the power over death. Why? Because he is the resurrection and the life. He wants you to be free today from every tomb that has you enslaved. Why? Because he is the resurrection and the life. He commands us, remove the stones that cover our tombs. Respond to me. Release what you gotta release. Reveal to others the glory of Jesus Christ. And I will restore you. How can I restore you? It's easy. I'm the resurrection. It's easy. I'm the life. I'm the source of life. I'm the giver of life. No man can take my life. I lay it down. And if I lay it down, I'll pick it back up. Why? Because I am the resurrection and the life today. Respond to the commands of God. Give God your heart, knowing that if you die in Jesus Christ, you'll live in Jesus Christ, because he is the resurrection and the life. God bless you.